but I asked Dallas to read the stuff later. Oh, he still really appreciated that message with those great names. Yeah, that's right. We're testing him. That's right. Ask God's blessing on our time as we look at His Word. Lord, this is such an important and wonderful passage of Scripture, and yet in some ways it's hard. And so we ask for Your instruction and Your help, the work of Your Spirit, that You would apply this in our lives. For You know our needs, You know our struggles, You know our past. So we just yield to what You want to do through this time now in Your Word. We believe that the Word of God is living and active and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing as far as the vision of soul and spirit, of both joint and marrow, and able to judge the thoughts and intentions of the heart. So we invite You by Your Spirit to even judge our thoughts and our intentions today. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. You know, as some of you have found out, like me, as we get older, it's harder and harder to stay in good health. Can I get an amen? Okay. All right, that's enough. I know for me, once I reached 40, I really began to notice, hey, I can't go running like I used to, or can't work out as hard, or go play basketball as much as I used to. And then once I hit 50, the party was really over. I've had back knee surgery when I was in high school, and a couple minor surgeries since. My back's not very good. I've got rheumatoid arthritis. And just, boy, by the time you hit 50, it just really catches up with you. And, you know, you try to go out running, and you cramp up. You just can't. You just can't do it. And so you have to work all the harder and pay all the more attention to what you eat and how you exercise. You know, you want to make sure that you're drinking plenty of water and trying to set aside the ice cream and the chocolate and eat your fruits and vegetables and do that kind of exercises that aren't as hard on your joints and yet building up your bones. And, you know, you all know how it works. It just gets harder and harder. We really have to work at, as we get older, all the more staying healthy. Well, God has given us a recipe here in this passage for the church to be healthy. These are some things we're going to talk about this morning for a church to be able to function as God wants us to function. Of course, much of it depends upon the people, the location, different circumstances that a church is going through or has been through. So each local church in its unique setting will be different, but these are some general things that we can apply along with others, but these are some general things that we can apply to be a healthy church. And so in Philippians 3, 17 through 4, verse 3, Paul gives us a recipe for having a healthy church. And the first is this: to have a healthy church, we must follow our spiritual examples. He says in verse 17, brethren, join in following my example and observe those who walk according to the pattern that you have in us. Basically, he's saying here, imitate me. The word that is translated example could be also translated to imitate. The word for pattern could also be translated example. And so Paul, as a leader in the church, is giving his life as an example of what it means to follow Christ. others that you should look to as an example. Not only follow me as I follow Christ, he says that on several occasions in the scriptures, like in 1 Corinthians 11:1. But he also refers to others in the church that people should look to. In this setting, Epaphroditus, Timothy, are two other examples that he's already talked about in this letter. Now, we certainly are clear that Jesus is the supreme example that we are to follow. But there should also be people around us who we look at their lives and should say, well, they're seeking to follow God. They may not do it perfectly, but they're seeking to walk with Him. And so I can learn from them as well. We think of the example that Paul gave in chapter 3 earlier. But whatever things were gained to me, those things I have gotten as lost for the sake of Christ. More than that, I've got all things to be lost in view of the surpassing value of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord. I mean, what an example of a follower of Christ with all zeal, with all boldness, with all passion. Let's go for it together, Paul says to us. I know that passage that we talked about last week is very influential in my own desire to walk with Christ and to follow Him with a whole heart. And I hope it served you as well last week. But if we're going to be a healthy church, we need to have people around us who are willing to say, like Paul, follow me as I follow Christ. And certainly, the elders should be those kinds of people. Again, not in any way that we are perfect. We all have our flaws, things we're working on. But one of the roles as elders is to be able to say, with humility, depending upon the work of God, the grace of God in our lives, to help the congregation as shepherds, follow me as I follow Christ. And so I believe one of the things I look at is if you can't say that about someone, that I would want my son or daughter to be like them as they follow Christ. They should be different. Again, we're all going to have our flaws. We're all going to be gifted differently. But do they encourage you because of their zeal, their passion, their giftedness, their hunger, their humility, whatever it is, to follow Christ? They encourage you to follow Christ. Not only the elders, but many among us should be those who are encouraging us and challenging us by their life, their commitment. There are many in this congregation who say, wow, I'm so glad God's using it that way, and they encourage me to continue on as a disciple of Jesus Christ. Small group leaders, community group leaders, Sunday school teachers, so many others, just people who are faithful in ministry. Not that any of us are perfect, but are there people around us who are really encouraging us and challenging us by their life, their commitment, their faithfulness to follow Christ? That really helps us to be a healthy church, help us all move forward. There should also be people in the church at large who help us do that. There are many in our day that we can mention, people like David Jeremiah, Ravi Zacharias, or Anne Graham Lodge, people who are serving the Lord with zeal. They make their mistakes. They're not perfect. They're not gifted in every area. But because of their commitment, their passion for the Lord, they encourage us to follow Him. Certainly, we can look at the historical church, to study the lives of those who've gone before us. And by reading biographies, which have been so influential to me in my Christian walk, by looking at their lives, studying history, seeing their mistakes, but how they had to trust God and how God used them. We're doing that this week with this whole Reformation theme. We celebrate the 500th year of Martin Luther putting up the 95 theses on the wall of the church, by the door of the Church of Wittenberg. Now, Martin Luther's not a perfect individual. If you go back to read church history, he had many mistakes, many theological issues that I would disagree with. I think he didn't go far enough in some ways. But he had to trust God. do radical things for his day, to step out of faith. But there's so many others as you study that period of history that just encourage you to say, yes, we can take risks for God and trust God. And Ulrich Zwingli and John Huss, John Wycliffe, Philip Melanchthon, and so many others who can encourage us to say, yes, they're not perfect, but they were really seeking to walk by faith. And that encourages me to walk by faith as well. And it really is a part of the historical idea of looking at people in history to be a pattern and encouragement to us of what it means to walk by faith and trust God. There are many in the Bible that we can study their lives and see how God used them and how they had to walk with God. Moses, Daniel, Paul, Peter. You can choose your favorites. There's so many. But they struggled. They had to deal with sin issues in their own lives, but they learned to trust God and God used them. And again, of course, most importantly, we spend time with Jesus. Because ultimately, He is the one to follow. And so I just want to encourage you today, surround yourself with people, whether it be people in this church, but people in the church at large that you listen to on the radio or a podcast, whatever it might be, or even reading, looking back into history, people who will challenge and encourage you to continue on in your faith. Because we all need that encouragement as we seek to multiply healthy disciples. So that's one of the things we can do as a healthy church. We must follow our spiritual examples. And to be a healthy church, we must not follow our spiritual enemies. Our spiritual enemies. What a sad section of scripture this is. Can you imagine Paul as the apostle? He's led so many to Christ and brought so many into the church, and yet he writes this, "For many walk, of whom I often told you, and now tell you even, that they are enemies of the cross of Christ, but in the destruction of God is their appetite, the glory is in their shame, but set the minds on earthly things." Enemies of the cross of Christ. He tells us their focus was not on Jesus, but serving and loving Him. They're focused on themselves, their own appetites, their fleshly being. They strayed away. Now, we ask the question, who are these people he's talking about here? And there is debate. We don't have the details enough. There's some things that we learn about them that would help us to get who they are. We've talked about the possibility of them being the Judaizers. Those who are focused on the idea that you have to become a Jew first before you can become a Christian. They were into you have to obey the law. Even men had to be circumcised before you could become a Christian. Others believe that these are people called, we would call them antinomians. No law. The law doesn't matter. You don't have to worry about obeying God. Do whatever you want because Jesus died on the cross. Therefore, He will forgive you. Whatever you do, God loves you. And don't worry about this life. The flesh doesn't matter. And so just do whatever you want. Those are the antinomians that believe in no law. So we're not exactly sure who these people are he's referring to, who are now enemies of the cross of Christ, who were once a part of the church. But it must have been so hard here for Paul to write about these. He says he's even crying as he writes because it just hurts his heart so much. They were once a part of the family. And though they've left the church and they're focused on themselves, he describes these people as fleshly people of the world. He says that their end is destruction. going to be in heaven. They will be eternally condemned, separated from God. Their God is their appetite. Their glory is their shame. He is referring to the Judaizers here who focus on the Jewish law. You have to be a Jew first before you can become a Christian. He could be talking about here, they're focusing on food laws. They're focusing even on circumcision, he could be referring to here, for their salvation. If he speaks of the antinomians, again, those are the ones who say, it doesn't matter what you do because God will forgive you and God loves you. It refers to their casual attitudes about modesty and moderation in life. They should be ashamed of what they're willing to do, but they don't care about the flesh. The flesh for them doesn't seem to matter. You can do with the flesh whatever you want because God will forgive you. Whichever it may be, and of course it could be something else that Paul specifically is referring to, they have a wrong focus. They're focusing on themselves. But they have become enemies of the cross of Christ. They have misunderstood and abused God's forgiveness through the cross. With all of this, we must ask ourselves, where's my focus? Have I made my Christianity about me? Is my focus on following Christ and trusting Him for my salvation, or am I focused on myself, the things of the world, and of the flesh? Some churches do that today. Some churches might say, well, you have to be baptized before you can go to heaven. It's almost like they're creating a law that you must do before put your faith in Christ. It's wrong focus. Some people say today, we hear this, well, Jesus paid for all my sins, so He'll forgive me and He loves me no matter what. Those are the antinomians. Doesn't matter what we do, as long as we pray to receive Christ. Or some would say, as long as I've been baptized, it doesn't matter how I live my life. But what He's telling us today is that if we are going to be a healthy church, we have to have a balance between grace and obedience. If we challenge one another to live for Christ in all we do, I hope you hear that on Sunday mornings. God wants us to walk in obedience. We're to be followers of Christ. We are to imitate Him. Now, I hope you hear that and understand that. But the beauty of the gospel is, even though that's what we strive to do, God doesn't get us into heaven because we're trying to get us to do a bunch of good works. God does love us, and He is gracious. And when we stumble and fall in our lives, we just say, Lord Jesus, I've blown it. I can't make it to heaven on my own. And so we trust in His grace and what He did for us on the cross through His death to pay for the penalty of our sins. So God does not save us because we try to be good people. He saves us. And we believe in Him, we receive Him because we recognize we can never be good enough on our own. It's only through Christ, after the cross, through His grace and love, that we have eternal life. But it is because of His glory and His majesty and His grace and His love and all He's done for us, we want to live for Him. So we don't take for granted what He did for us on the cross. Because if we're saying, well, yeah, I've received Jesus, and therefore I can do whatever I want to do, we've misunderstood. Christ hasn't changed our heart. So yes, we want to walk in obedience, but we do that because we are motivated by His grace and His love, and we're just so thankful that we can continue to depend upon the cross and His forgiveness. lives. So to be a healthy church, we must follow our spiritual examples and not our spiritual enemies. And then third, to be a healthy church, we must focus on our heavenly home. I really enjoyed the Sunday school class this morning. Just such a good reminder. Things in the heaven, things in the new heaven and new earth are not going to be like they are today. That was so good. See, there's so much to look forward to. And what we have to come through Jesus Christ. This is a beautiful reminder, this passage, verses 30, 20, and 21. For our citizenship is in heaven, from which we also eagerly wait for a Savior. I'll get more eager through this Sunday school class. But the focus is there. The Lord Jesus, eagerly wait for a Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, who will transform the body of our humble faith into conformity with the body of His glory by the exertion of the power that He has even to subject all things to Himself. What a beautiful reminder this passage is, that this world, even this body as it is not our own. I have been encouraged here today. As I talked about, my body is failing. And I know many of us are struggling with our bodies. I mean, how many replacements have we had in this church in the last couple of months? Right? But this body and this world is not our home. Hallelujah. When Paul writes this about the citizenship being in heaven, this would have been very pertinent and painted quite a picture for the church in Philippi. One author writes this in the phrase citizenship in heaven. He says, when Augustus Caesar became the first Roman emperor about 20 years before the birth of Christ, Roman armies had conquered a territory stretching throughout the Middle East and Europe. Within these vast borders, peoples of many cultures and languages lived and worked. Augustus saw that the only hope of maintaining imperial authority over this vast territory lay in joining its population through Roman traditions and ideas. As cities were conquered, colonies of soldiers were formed. These veterans, the conquered soldiers, were given citizenship as Romans, though in faraway lands. Augustus extended this practice by giving full Roman citizenship not only to settlements of veterans, but to important provincial cities and to men who had distinguished themselves in public service. These provincial communities held equal rights and privileges with the citizens of Rome itself, and in return they were expected to represent Rome and all things Roman to their neighbors, so that the Roman lifestyle might permeate their province. The policy proved extremely successful. Philippi was one of these colonies. Now think about that. Many of these people had been granted Roman citizenship, but with that giving of citizenship, there was an expectation of them to live like Romans. Not to live their old lifestyle, but to represent Rome well, even though they were in Philippi. And so think about how when the church in Philippi hears this pronouncement by Paul that they're citizens of heaven, what that would mean to the church in Rome. Oh, in a foreign land. We are to represent our citizenship well. Yes, we live here on earth. We live here in the United States. But God here as I read of what Jesus talked about in the Sermon on the Mount, because what the Sermon on the Mount basically is how to live in His kingdom while on earth. Yes, we are in this world, but we are not to be of this world. We are to live as citizens of heaven, representing our King well while He gives us time. So because you walk with integrity at work, or you have patience with those who snap at you, or because you show compassion when others are mean-spirited, even because you drive with courtesy rather than hostility, you are representing your true citizenship. That's what God has for us. We need to ask of ourselves, am I representing God well? Am I representing His kingdom well? Or am I living like everyone else in the world? We should be different. Are you living a different lifestyle than the world around you? Do people see a difference in you because you're a citizen of heaven? Paul reminds us that though we seek to represent God well in this life, he reminds us in verse 21 of this passage that we are to wait eagerly for a Savior. He's our true hope. He will change our bodies by His mighty power. We will be with Him for eternity, and we can look forward with great anticipation. We can await eagerly that coming day when we'll no longer have to mess with all this junk. But we'll be in His presence. We read this passage in Sunday school this morning from 1 Corinthians 15. This is the end of the passage of what we read. Again, the reminder of our hope of a new body, of a changed life. For Paul writes, "Behold, I tell you a mystery. We will not all sleep, but we will all be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet, for the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised imperishable, and we will be changed. For this perishable must put on the imperishable, and this mortal must put on immortality. But when this perishable will have put on the imperishable, and this mortal will have put on immortality, then will come about the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory." What a day that will be. So we need to ask ourselves again, what is my focus in life? If we're to follow Paul's recipe, we're to focus on Christ and the things of heaven. And this will motivate us to live as citizens of heaven and to represent God well, and we will be more and more of the church. Because we're not living for this world. We're living for Him. To be a healthy church, we must follow our spiritual examples, not follow our spiritual enemies, focus on our eternal home. As well, to be a healthy church, we must stand firm in the Lord. Stand firm in the Lord. He says in verse 1, "Therefore, my beloved brethren, whom I long to see, my joy and crown, in this way stand firm in the Lord." My beloved. This is really a transition sentence for Paul as he moves from his previous discussion of facing enemies of the cross. And now he says, even in the midst of enemies, even in the midst of a culture that's against you, against the church, and doesn't honor the word of God, stand firm. Stand firm. Persevere, continue to preach the gospel, and stand on His word, no matter what people around you, no matter what the culture or how the culture around you reacts, because we believe this is the truth of heroes in the faith is John Wesley. I have many, just one, but I want you to listen to this entry in his diary of a man who stood firm. John Wesley, the great preacher, said in his diary, Sunday morning, May 5th, preached in St. Anne's, was asked not to come back in evil. Sunday p.m., they used to have two services. Some of you may remember that. They had two services, one in the morning and one in the evening. Sunday p.m., May 5th, priest at St. John's, deacon said, get out and stay out. Sunday a.m., May 12th, priest at St. Jude's, can't go back there either. Sunday p.m., May 12th, priest at St. George's, kicked out again. Sunday a.m., May 19th, priest at St. somebody else's, deacon's called special meeting and said, I can return. Sunday p.m., May 19th, preached on the street, kicked off the street. Sunday a.m., May 26th, preached in the meadow, chased out of meadow as a bull was turned loose during the service. Sunday a.m., June 2nd, preached out at the edge of town, kicked off the highway. Sunday p.m., June 2nd, afternoon service, preached in a pasture, 10,000 people entered. Sometimes it's easy, isn't it, to look back at our heroes in the faith and think they had it all easy. It was all roses for them. No problems, no issues, no difficulties. Here was a man who said, no matter what, God's called me to preach His word, and I'm going to stand firm in the Lord and do what God's called me to do. I want to encourage each of us this morning, whatever you're going through in your life, keep standing firm in the Lord. This life is not going to be easy. We all face tribulations and struggles. Keep trusting Him. Keep persevering in the faith. Always remember your eternal home. Always remember what Christ suffered for you because He loves you. And He wants to help you and encourage you, and that He conquered sin and death on the third day. He rose again from the dead. And therefore, no matter what we face in this life, we can stand firm. Not in our own power and strength, not in our education or our background or our status or our money, but we stand firm in the Lord. Who He is and what He's done for us. And I want you to know this morning that as long as I'm the teaching pastor at this church, we're going to stand firm in the Lord. We're going to stand firm in the Lord. We know that things have not always been easy in this church. Ministry has not always gone smoothly. But I'm so thankful that I serve on a team of elders, of men who seek to stand firm in the Lord. We're not perfect men by any stretch. We make difficult decisions. We're not always even sure of all of our decisions, but we seek to honor God in all we do. And I'm so thankful that we are part of a denomination that, again, we wrestle with different issues and we're not perfect men and women, but we serve in a denomination that says we are going to stand upon the Word of God and stand firm in the Lord. I just felt the need to say that this morning because, my friends, there are so many churches out there, even in this community, who have gone astray. They once were followers of John Wesley or John Calvin, great men of God. But they weren't perfect either, but they were seeking to honor God. People like Martin Luther. And yet today, they're not standing firm in the Lord. But we are going to continue to seek to spread the gospel and be involved in events like the Todd Becker Foundation, we're going to seek to make disciples and encourage others through ministries like our International Student Fellowship. We're going to continue to be involved in the Great Commission to work with our missionaries who are spreading the gospel around the world and to help build God's church in places like Burkina Faso, Cambodia, and Russia. There are going to come times in our church where we are disturbing. It's not going to always be easy. But I want all of you to know this story. The leadership of this church is going to help us and lead us to stand firm in the Lord. In a healthy church, we must follow our spiritual examples, not follow our spiritual enemies. Focus on our heavenly home and stand firm in the Lord. And then finally, to be a healthy church, we must live in harmony in the Lord. You know, it's just amazing. You can read in Scripture, even in the early church, they struggled with this. They struggled with relationships. Verses 2 and 3 in chapter 4, I urge Yodia and her Syntyche to live in harmony in the Lord and teach her companion. I ask you also to help these women who have shared my struggle in the cause of the gospel, together with them and also to the rest of my fellow workers whose names are in the book of life. Paul is reminding them to encourage one another, to help one another. He's given his life to them. He doesn't want them to be at odds with one another. Yodia and Syntyche were not treating each other as mature followers of Christ, as sisters in the gospel. He says, be of the same mind. He talked about that earlier in chapter 2. Give yourself for one another. Serve one another. God says, share. God says, work it out. Don't act like kids. But focusing on yourself and focus on the work of the gospel, on evangelism, discipleship, preaching, missions, loving Jesus, loving one another. It's the reminder here for all of us. Paul also calls Syntyche, which is often translated true comrade or true companion. It may be saying true companion, or he may be using a name here, we're not quite sure, but this person may be an elder or pastor in the church, and he's asking that person to intervene in this relationship, and it got that bad. Now, sometimes we need that, don't we? We can't get it worked out amongst a couple of individuals, and so the elders or other church leaders are called in to help out, to bring some kind of reconciliation to the situation. We certainly want to be available for that in our church as well. But in all of this, Paul is saying, let's not waste any more time focusing on our own needs, our own flesh, and arguments that distract us from following Christ. Let's work through the difficulties. There are difficulties. But press on to the true business of the church, following Jesus. So these are just basic things that Paul has given us in this passage to help us be a healthy church. The wrong way is to focus on ourselves, to focus on those who are against us. The right recipe is to focus on our spiritual examples, to focus on our home with the Lord, to stand firm in the Lord, and live in harmony together in the Lord. You know, as I considered this message this week, and some of you have been around this church a lot longer than I have, but I'm so thankful that God's worked in our church. Because I think we're pretty healthy. And I give them all the praise for that. Because this church has gone through struggles and issues. The leadership of this church has continued to try to apply these things and other things from the Word and to stand firm and stay consistent. to where we have not a perfect, but a pretty healthy church. But we have to keep walking in the Spirit, don't we? And walking in His grace, submitting to one another, and loving one another, and keeping our focus on the things of God, not on the things of this earth, our own wants, our own flesh. I believe that God will continue and even further use us as we trust Him. Great days ahead. Let's look forward to it together and work at it together. Let's pray. Lord, we are so excited what You're doing in the life of our church. We're seeing unique and wonderful ministries happen right now. And I believe that You're blessing us in many ways as You're working in our own lives as individuals, bringing reconciliation and encouragement, people confessing their sins, people coming to faith in Christ and seeking to focus on the things above. But we just cry out, Lord, we just cry out, keep working. We want to stay yielded before You. We want to humble ourselves before You. Because it's not if we're better or worse than another church. Jesus, You are our example. And we want to follow You with a whole heart. We want to come alongside other churches and be involved in Your work in this community with others who love You. In this region, with others who love You and seek to bring people to Christ and make disciples, and certainly around the world. And so we just continue to offer ourselves, Lord. We want to be healthy.